Of course, they can high and can low like this are considered differential voltage. What does that mean? It means the transceiver reads the difference between them and converts it to logic 1 or 0, which are either recessive or dominant, and outputs them to the TX and RX. Stay with me on this. All right, let's dive into this. What's the benefit of using single-ended over differential? Well, with single-ended, you're dealing with just one wire. If this wire encounters any electrical magnetic inductance or interference, the signal output will include both the original signal and the added noise. Now, on the other hand, with differential, I'm using two twisted wires. When these wires pick up noise, since they're twisted together, they're likely to pick up the same amount of noise. But because I'm looking at the difference between them, I effectively get rid of that noise. So I usually set the positive voltage, denoted as V plus on one of these wires, and the negative voltage, denoted as V minus on the other. Now let's say the noise that's added is represented by N. When you calculate the difference, it works out V plus NN. This term will be minus negative V plus N. That would be equal to V, and noise will be removed. So when I subtract one from the other, the overall signal amplifies, becoming twice as strong, while the noise essentially becomes zero. Focus on this, as it's quite an insightful aspect of differential signaling. Okay, let's break this down. The transceiver has the capability to convert the transmit wire, which is single-ended, to send its data over the CAN high and CAN low. And from CAN high and CAN low, it also converts them back to the receive wire, which is AX, so you can read what you've sent. Now, the CAN high and CAN low wires are twisted together. This is done so that if any noise does come in, it affects both wires equally. As a result, when you consider the difference between them, this noise effectively cancels out. It's a neat trick to ensure the integrity of the transmitted data. Stay with me here. These concepts are fundamental in understanding CAN communication. All right, let's dive in. Once upon a time, they primarily used the low-speed CAN bus. However, as time progressed, the transition to the high-speed CAN bus took place, which is what most of us work with nowadays. Practically, no one uses the low-speed version anymore. Remember, in this context, a logic 0 is termed as dominant, while a logic 1 is called recessive. Now, when discussing the high-speed CAN bus, the principle revolves around high and low voltage states. To represent a logic 0 or dominant state, the high should be at 3.5 volts and the low at 1.5 volts. The difference between them gives us 2 volts, indicating a dominant state, which translates to logic 0. However, if both the high and low are at 2.5 volts, subtracting them results in 0 volts. This 0 volt state is termed as recessive, signifying a logic 1. This is how the bus functions in high-speed mode. Now, even though the low speed isn't utilized, it has its own distinct calculations. But don't stress yourself out with that. Well, you need to concern yourself with is the TX and RX, checking whether they're representing A1 or 0. But as for how the transceiver operates on the CAN high and CAN low, leave that to the experts. You don't need to delve into those intricacies. As you can see, 0 volts represents recessive, while 2 volts indicates dominant. What's above is what we refer to as TTL, which stands for the serial or digital wires. From this TTL, we get the TX and RX wires. Meanwhile, the transceiver produces the CAN high and CAN low, and it calculates the difference between them. In the market, you'll find transceivers that operate on a power supply of 3.3 volts. Another transceiver, which I use in all our case studies, is the Cheetan 50. It's readily available, works perfectly, supports high speed up to 1 megabit per second, and can go up to 1,000 meters. It operates on a VCC of 5 volts. Also, if you can't find any of those transceivers, there's the Maxi 2551. All it needs is a 120 ohm resistor to be connected. The previous two had this by default. This transceiver that I'm talking about, which we use in our case studies, consists of a VCC and ground. It has TX and RX that connect to the CAN controller. The VCC connects to your microcontroller's power supply, which is 5 volts. You'll also find the CAN high and CAN low in it, and between them, there's already a 130 ohm resistor. For those using the MC251, that's how it's connected. Plus, you must add the 120 ohm resistor that I mentioned earlier. Here, it shows the nodes, which send data over the bus, and you can also see the bus itself. Of course, as we discussed earlier, our bit rate decreases as we increase the distance or length of the bus. The ISO is responsible for the twisted pair concept. We handle the TX and X as digital, while the transceiver converts them into a differential twisted pair wire. Focus with me on this part if you're working at a speed of 1000 kilo bit per second. Keep in mind that this part has been asked to a lot of people in interviews. I mean, some people who said they know about CAN were asked about this part and they contacted me. This part, I've explained it very, very, very well in case study one. Case study one, I explained the bit timing calculation in full, but I'll just give you a hint about it now. When you say you're going to send 100 kilobit per second, it means you're saying you'll send 1 million bits in 1 second. So how much time does a single bit take for you? A single bit takes time 1 microsecond. This 1 microsecond is divided into 4 parts, and the sampling happens at the range 75%. These 4 parts have specific ranges, and there are registers controlling these ranges. If you set these ranges incorrectly, you won't be able to receive correctly. Now, go listen to this in case study 1. As it's explained in great detail,